Hi friends, welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. In a disease that's neurodegenerative, in other words, a disease where parts of the neurological system are degenerating or breaking down, it would seem like it would be paramount to keep those cells from degenerating any further, would it not? If that's the case, which I think we'll all agree on, you'll want to stick around for this episode to find out more about how hyperbaric oxygen therapy could be a solution in preventing further cell death and protecting neurological tissue in Parkinson's disease. Let's roll. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. And for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. Now, before we dive into the Parkinson's connection, let's talk a little bit about hyperbaric oxygen therapy and what the heck that even is. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy has actually been around for quite a while, around the neighborhood of 100 years that it's been used in the United States in particular. Hyperbaric oxygen has been used to treat various conditions. Some notable examples are a person who has carbon monoxide poisoning. Another example would be somebody, let's say, that has type 2 diabetes that might have foot ulcers or other wounds in the lower body. Or it could be somebody that just has some form of peripheral vascular disease that doesn't have good blood flow and they need oxygen to be increased in those tissues to help with wound healing or other tissue healing. I neglected to mention that hyperbaric oxygen therapy refers to sitting or lying in a chamber where you're subjected to pressurized oxygen. So typically the dosage is what they call 2 atmospheres, which is basically twice the pressure that you would normally experience in the natural Earth's atmosphere. So by doing such, you're infusing that oxygen across the skin into the bloodstream directly. Just to recap a little bit for what we've talked about previously, Parkinson's disease, particularly the cells involved in the substantia nigra pars compacta in the midbrain, those are our main dopaminergic cells. They produce the most dopamine of any cell group in the brain. Those are the cells that are systemically dying off in Parkinson's disease, which results in the disorder we know as Parkinson's. The substantia nigra pars compacta cells are particularly susceptible to mitochondrial damage from various sources. It could be the genetic links to Parkinson's disease, or it could be external factors that cause mutations, such as toxin exposures and so forth. Mitochondrial damage results in reactive oxygen species, which ultimately will result in Parkinson's disease particularly, we're talking about alpha-synuclein aggregation, which causes further cell and nerve damage. Also, programmed cell death, which is otherwise known as apoptosis. Now, apoptosis happens in normal cellular processes. In other words, there's always cellular turnover going on in the body. Think of your skin, for example. You don't ever have the same layer of skin at the epidermal layer your entire life. It continuously dies off, regenerates, dies off, regenerates. I mean, if you didn't, you'd never have dead skin. It's perfectly natural for certain organs to have cells that undergo turnover because the body needs to renew itself. That's just part of normal homeostasis for the human body. So don't take it to mean that any cell death at all is to be prevented. What we're specifically talking about in this instance is the connection of apoptosis with the substantia nigra cells in the brain. Those cells we need to protect at all costs. A summary of the studies that I was able to glean off of PubMed, among other sites, is that there's not a whole lot of specific human research being done at this point for hyperbaric oxygen therapy and Parkinson's disease. There was a study fairly in the last 5 or 10 years. By the way, the 2 studies in particular that I was able to find pretty quickly are from the East in Asia. They're not from the West. So it's interesting that the Eastern physicians and researchers are looking into this, seemingly more recently, even more than the people on the Western side. But in summary of what I was able to find, hyperbaric oxygen therapy has the potential to protect nerve cells and the mitochondria of those nerve cells, particularly through stimulation of the SIRT1 or sirtuin pathway, which helps with mitochondrial biogenesis. In other words, it helps mitochondria to regenerate and to heal. Also, promising results in that study showed that there's a potential for hyperbaric oxygen therapy to increase BDNF production, which is, if you remember previously, is neuroprotective as well. It's called brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which means that it helps support existing healthy nerve cells. In a case study I was able to find, again from the East in Asia, they had a gentleman that had Parkinson's disease and some other psychiatric symptoms that were going on with his Parkinson's, particularly some cognitive issues and depression. And he underwent hyperbaric oxygen therapy without any medications other than the hyperbaric oxygen treatment. And he had positive results in both the UPDRS scale as well as with his psychiatric symptoms. I'll link those, each of those studies, in the description below. What these results of research tell me is that this is an ongoing area of research, not something where the door has been closed to say it won't help or it will help in persons with Parkinson's disease. I hope that we do find more studies on this. If you've been able to find more research on this that I haven't, please add that in the comments below. I would like to be enlightened and certainly open up that door for more conversation. I'll even do a follow-up video if I need to explain that further. What are the pros and cons of hyperbaric oxygen therapy? One of you subscribers actually reached out to me and told me about your experience doing hyperbaric oxygen therapy combined with glutathione and photobiomodulation, which is red light therapy, up in Michigan at the Oxford Clinic. Now, this is one person's experience, so his experience was quite positive. However, not necessarily earth-shattering, but results may vary. Depending on how early or late someone is in the disease process, this could make a big difference. This particular subscriber is a gentleman who's been diagnosed within the last year and a half. The downsides to hyperbaric oxygen therapy from talking with this gentleman and doing some research is mainly that it's just time-consuming. You're there for a lot of time and a lot of days per week at first, so it takes a couple of hours to get everything done. You're having to travel to a site to do it. Obviously, the upside is that you might have improvement in symptoms without increasing any drugs, with the exception of supplementing glutathione, which is not a prescription medication. It's not a medication at all, in fact. It's a supplement of an existing natural product that your body produces. So just to summarize, hyperbaric oxygen therapy is a safe possible adjunctive treatment for Parkinson's disease, especially combined with supplemental therapies like glutathione, as well as something like red light therapy or photobiomodulation. If you want to check out a little bit more of an individual that has done photobiomodulation or red light therapy for his Parkinson's disease, be sure to check out my friend David Gebhardt's channel, Life with Parkinson's, where he has some specific video. In fact, I'll link the actual video up here where he's talked about his experiences with the red light therapy, so you can kind of decide for yourselves if that's something you might want to try. But regardless of that, it's a safe potential adjunctive treatment for Parkinson's, and it's one of those things where there's not really any guarantees it will help, but it can't hurt. It's worth a try, especially if it gives you any alleviation of symptoms. But the main thing here is not 100% symptom relief, it's also prevention of the disease progression, and that's huge too. Imagine combining something like this with high intensity exercise multiple days a week, supplementation, and so forth. The less medication you can be on and the more supplements and more physical activity and so forth you're doing, that's even better, because you're helping the body to heal as naturally as possible and to protect itself as naturally as possible. That's kind of the whole idea behind all these topics we've been doing recently with supplements and adjunctive treatments. That's also not to negate the need for medication when it's called for. I'm not advocating for not having medication whatsoever. However, I individually do recommend to people to hold off on some of the Parkinson's meds as long as possible. If their physician will work with them on that, and if they won't, probably it's worth finding another opinion. Because a lot of times when people are on levodopa for long periods of time, you have a lot of negative side effects and more dependence on the drug. You have to take higher and higher doses over time, and then you get the negative effects that can come with higher doses of levodopa, such as dyskinesia. And also remember, Parkinson's medications can also magnify symptoms, not just treat them. So overprescribing things can also make things worse, let alone not taking them at all. But all that to say that trying to take something to keep dopamine levels a little more stable, like an MAOB inhibitor, COMT inhibitor, amantadine, something along those lines, might be a better first-end approach than going right into levodopa or carbidopa levodopa, which seems to be the majority of cases in my experience. I don't want to get off on a soapbox on that, but anything you can do that would be a safe adjunct to treatment that you're doing in Parkinson's is just a great thing to consider, because the medications don't really prevent progression. They only treat symptoms, and that's the bottom line. Thank you, as always, for being here for this episode. Please leave your comments below on YouTube. Give us a 5-star review on your favorite podcast app if you feel like we deserve that, and I'll see you in the next episode. Bye-bye.